Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Culture of Military Organizations, edited by Peter R. Mansoor and William Murray, narrated by Tom Parks. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to figures present in the print and ebook versions of the book. Introduction: Peter R. Mansoor and William Murray. Culture has an enormous influence on military organizations and institutions and their success or failure in the ultimate arbitration of war. One can broadly define organizational culture as the assumptions, ideas, norms, and beliefs expressed or reflected in symbols, rituals, myths, and practices that shape how an organization functions and adapts to external stimuli and that give meaning to its members. Isabel Hall, who has written one of the clearest historical works to date on military culture, defines it as the habitual practices, default programs, hidden assumptions, and unreflected cognitive frames that underpin how an organization functions. Except in unique circumstances, in the initial founding of an organization, or when it undergoes severe trauma, culture grows slowly over time, embedding itself so deeply into its processes that members often act unconsciously according to its dictates. This may have positive benefits. American service members, for instance, are imbued with the cultural ethic to leave no soldier behind on the battlefield, which undoubtedly enhances morale and willingness to fight rather than flee, knowing that one's comrades will be at one's side if the worst occurs. But culture may also have negative consequences, especially when it locks an organization into dated and inappropriate ways of operating, as occurred with the Royal Navy in the period leading up to the Battle of Jutland in World War I. Culture can also act as a catalyst to increase the brutality of war and, in other cases, to decrease it. Because culture lies hidden under more visible organizational doctrine and symbols, one can easily overlook its power. Nevertheless, writes Hall, organizational culture is more likely to determine action than is explicit policy or ideology. Culture has two major impacts on an organization. First, it creates organizational identity, that is, the distinctive attributes that make the organization different from others. The U.S. Marine Corps, for instance, prides itself on being a flexible expeditionary force capable of rapid deployment at the orders of the president. The U.S. Army has a few units with the same ethos, but the organization as a whole is America's Army, designed to fight and win the nation's wars. Marine leaders expect short, sharp engagements, while Army leaders aim to fight over the long haul. The two cultures sometimes collide, as occurred in the invasion of Saipan in June 1944, when Marine Lieutenant General Holland Howland Mad Smith relieved U.S. Army Major General Ralph Smith over the latter's perceived lack of aggressiveness in fighting through the mountainous interior of the island. Second, culture establishes expectations of how group members will act in a given situation. The German Army's emphasis on operational maneuver in both world wars, for instance, led senior leaders to ignore more salient aspects of strategy, in particular, economic mobilization and logistics. Germany's senior military leaders, imbued with a culture of tactical and operational excellence, believed that maneuver would achieve quick victories over major powers, thus enabling Germany to overcome Great Britain, the Soviet Union, and the United States, despite the vast latent industrial power of the Allies. This culture ultimately resulted in the destruction of the Wehrmacht as Allied forces overran Germany in the spring of 1945. The problem for senior military leaders is not just the difficulty in understanding culture, but in using it to further the goals of the organization. Even harder is changing culture when it becomes antithetical to organizational needs. A highly respected Marine general once commented to one of the editors that changing culture is like trying to turn a large cruise liner. It can only occur slowly. These problems exist despite the best intentions of leaders and managers to get culture. One authority on organizational culture writes, "However, even in those cases where top managers have a strong awareness of the significance of culture, there is often a lack of a deeper understanding of how people and organizations function in terms of culture. Culture is as significant and complex as it is difficult to understand and use in a thoughtful way. One of the purposes of this book is to help military leaders understand how organizational culture forms, the influence culture has on organizational functioning and the development of strategy, operations, and tactics, and how culture changes. Culture is clearly a crucial determinant to the effectiveness of military organizations. It may come as a surprise, then, that perhaps the best study in this genre left out culture as a determinant of military effectiveness. In the three volumes of Military Effectiveness, focused on World War I, the interwar period, and World War II, editors Alan R. Millett and Williamson Murray, also the co-editor of this volume, posited a number of factors influencing military effectiveness, defined as the process by which armed forces convert resources into fighting power. Among these factors are the ability of an armed force to operate within the political milieu to obtain manpower and resources, the fashioning of strategies to achieve political goals, the matching of ways and means to the ends of strategy, the ability to operate within the context of an alliance, the development of doctrine to maximize the capabilities of various arms and services, the willingness of the officer corps to realistically examine the problems confronting an armed force, the reasonable integration of available technology, a co-equal emphasis on support elements such as intelligence and logistics, and tactical flexibility and adaptability. To be fair, the editors warned that one must include in the analysis non-quantifiable organizational attitudes, behaviors, and relationships that span a military organization's full activities at the political, strategic, operational, and tactical levels. But organizational culture was not an explicit element of the study, and chapter authors, for the most part, did not address it. The intention of this volume, then, is to revise and expand the discussion of military effectiveness by focusing on the role played by organizational and strategic culture in its development. Of all the factors involved in military effectiveness, culture is perhaps the most important. Yet it also remains the most difficult to describe and understand because it involves so many external factors that impinge, warp, and distort its formation and continuities, even in different military organizations within the same nation. These factors explain why it is so difficult for military organizations to change their fundamental underlying culture. Thus, even catastrophic military defeat can have relatively little impact on an organization's underlying culture. The performance of the Italian Piedmontese military in losing or performing badly in a series of wars from the mid-19th century through to its dismal performance during World War II underlines the point that military organizations do not necessarily learn from their defeats. As Professor McGregor Knox has pointed out about the culture of the Italian Army senior leadership, the fundamental problem was the Italian general staff tradition, Costoza, Lissa, Adua, Caporetto. On those occasions, the military distinguished itself by the absence of the study, planning, and attention to detail that characterized the Germans, and by a tendency to intrigue and confuse responsibilities among senior officers. In fact, history suggests that largely because of underlying and systemic factors, it has proven extraordinarily difficult to change the basic culture of military organizations. Despite the foregoing discussion, all too many historians and other commentators argue that military defeat can have a profound impact on the culture of military organizations. More often than not, they cite the example of the German army in the interwar period as having reacted effectively in response to its disastrous defeat in World War I, and thus created modern armored warfare. In fact, the Germans did develop impressive ground forces in the interwar period that had a significant impact in the first 2 years of World War II. However, those successes rested entirely on the tactical revolution that the Germans had initiated in the last 2 years of World War I. Moreover, in the larger sense, the German military, and not just the army, failed to learn the more important strategic lessons of the war. Having taken on effectively all of the great powers outside Central Europe between 1914 and 1918, it managed to repeat the same strategic mistake in the next conflict, creating a strategic situation where the Germans, to all intents and purposes, ended up fighting all of the other major powers in Europe, with the United States again thrown in for good measure. Yet military cultures do change over time. Horatio Nelson's mantra at Trafalgar summed up the Royal Navy's culture from 1757 to 1815. No captain can do very wrong if he places his ship alongside that of the enemy. It was a culture that demanded initiative, independent decision-making, and leadership at least down to the level of its captains. A century-plus later at Jutland, the captains of Lord Jellicoe's battle fleet exhibited none of these qualities. Over that period, the organizational culture of the Royal Navy had shifted 180 degrees. Significantly, the leaders of the Royal Navy were so humiliated by their performance in 1916 that they instigated major changes in the Navy's culture, so that the performance of the organization improved drastically by the onset of World War II, both in its surface battles in the Mediterranean and in the adaptability of its surface forces to the U-boat threat. Three important external factors impact military culture: geography, history, and the nature of the environment in which navies, armies, and air forces exist. Geography forms the basic context within which the past has influenced and determined the framework within which armed forces and their leaders view the world. As in real estate, geography is a matter of location, location, location. The events that transpired at Dunkirk in late May and early June 1940 were to a great extent influenced by the fact that the British viewed Land's End very differently from the Germans, and the French for that matter. To the continental militaries, the end of solid ground represented the termination of military operations. To the British, the ocean represented a great highway, an avenue of escape from the vicissitudes of the ground operations that had turned out so badly for them in northern France. Thus, the Germans, largely for cultural reasons, bungled the last stages of their campaign that destroyed the French army, but not that of Great Britain. Significantly, that sense of the ocean as a great highway has been the basis of British strategy and Britain's military culture since the end of the 17th century. Nevertheless, naval power by itself could not win or even influence to a considerable degree the wars of the great continental powers. But Britain's relative invulnerability that resulted from its geography as an island allowed that nation eventually to control the world's oceans. British strategists also provided significant financial and military aid to Britain's allies on the continent to keep them in the fight, particularly in the wars against Louis XIV and Napoleon. This twofold strategy of providing substantial military aid and financial support to Britain's allies, while dominating the world's oceans, allowed the British to overcome opponents with substantially greater resources. In the Great Emperor's case, the British confronted a France in control of nearly the entire European continent. This strategy was made possible by a Royal Navy imbued with a culture of independent initiative and aggressiveness that made it feasible for Britain to blockade the continent, ferry British forces to distant battlefields, and keep the British trading economy going, even as its continental adversaries controlled much of Europe. During the Seven Years' War, British Prime Minister William Pitt's strategy of controlling the world's oceans allowed the British to conduct major operations for the control of Canada and the Caribbean islands, while they were at the same time providing substantial ground forces and subsidies to assist Frederick the Great in repelling the combined assaults of France, Austria, and Russia. The one time during the 18th century that the British failed to secure firm alliances on the continent, namely during the war against the American revolutionaries, they suffered a major defeat and lost the American colonies in the process. We should also note that the fact that France, one of Europe's greatest powers, lies immediately across the English Channel, has had a profound effect on how the English and then the British have viewed the world. During the Age of Sail, the Low Countries represented a major invasion threat to those directing strategy in London. Elizabeth I took a major risk in supporting the Dutch against the overweening power of Philip II Spain, because Spanish control of the Low Countries represented an enormous strategic threat to the British Isles. Similarly, the support rendered by English and then British governments to the Second Hundred Years' War against the French from 1688 through 1815 represented a strategic vision that largely determined British strategic culture, a vision rooted in the geography of the English Channel and the North Sea. In many respects, the strategy followed in the 20th century by American leaders has reflected the same geographic realities that enabled Britain to succeed in earlier centuries. To all intents and purposes, the United States is an island. Its neighbors to the north and south since the War of 1812 and the Mexican-American War of 1847 have never represented a significant threat. Thus, throughout the 20th century, the Americans have used North America as an economic and military springboard to project military power across the great oceans that separate them from the rest of the world. In World War I, their economic strength kept the Allies in the war. And in 1918, the arrival of great masses of American infantry in France helped to tip the military balance against the Germans, and finally made the blockade of the Central Powers effective. In World War II, the United States was truly the arsenal of democracy, but its success rested on a strategic culture that understood the importance of logistics, economic realities, and the difficulties involved in the projection of power over immense distances. While the Cold War never became hot, the presence of American troops, air forces, and naval power in Europe and Korea kept the balance relatively stable and prevented the disaster of a nuclear war. For continental powers, the influence of geography on strategic culture is obviously quite different. For the French, the fact that they have always bordered on a major power has had a profound impact on their history. Thus, their efforts against the Spanish in the 16th and early 17th centuries reflected deep fears about the security of a nation confronted on three sides by Spanish military forces in the Pyrenees, Italy, and Flanders. And, of course, there was the problem posed by English and later British sea power, which forced the French to divide their military strength between sea power and land power, neither of which they mastered, except when they were led by a Corsican military genius, Napoleon. The Germans are an interesting case because, for most of their history, the Reich was nothing more than a collection of mini-states with no ability to craft anything resembling a common strategy. Prussia emerged in the 18th century to provide something resembling a German state, but Prussia's existence depended very much not only on the strength of its army, but also on the strategic wisdom of its leadership. The military disaster of 1806 underlined its geographic limitations and was to have a profound impact on the military culture that evolved in the 19th century. The Iron Chancellor, Otto von Bismarck, through his brilliant understanding of the weaknesses of Germany's strategic competitors, as well as the milieu in which he was operating, was able to create a unified Germany. But after the War in Sight crisis of 1875, he understood how vulnerable Germany was, surrounded as it was on three sides by great powers. Despite Bismarck's admonitions, the culture that dominated the German military at the end of the 19th century paid no attention to the Reich's strategic position or to the fact that the only resource that Germany would control in substantial amounts was coal. Thus, Kaiser Wilhelm II disregarded virtually all of Bismarck's policies and, in addition, created the High Seas Fleet, an explicit threat to the British, thereby driving the British into the arms of the French and their Russian allies. The German nation in the 20th century would pay a terrible price for ignoring the dictates of geography by embracing a culture that instead emphasized operational, tactical, and technical effectiveness at the expense of sound strategy. Equally important, and to the detriment of German military culture, is the fact that the Reich's position in Europe has meant that it has always been located near the center of major wars. Consequently, the German military in the wars of German unification had to pay relatively little attention to logistics in its conduct of military operations. By 1914, the development of operational plans ignored any factors that impeded maneuver and the attempt to destroy enemy armies in great Kesselschlachten or battles of encirclement. The Schlieffen Plan in 1914 was not just an operational failure, but also a logistical one. By the time the Germans approached Paris and the Marne, they were almost out of ammunition, while their food situation had reached such dire straits that officers were issuing the troops wine to keep them going, with obvious results. In World War II, the extraordinary distances over which the Wehrmacht operated, from the North Cape to North Africa and from the Volga to the Atlantic Ocean, meant that logistics was a crucial factor in military operations. And here, the Germans proved disastrously inept. The failure of Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union, was above all a failure of logistics. Even after the war was over, General Franz Halder, the chief of the Oberkommando des Heeres, army staff from 1938 to 1942, commented that quartermaster logisticians must never hamper operational concepts, a statement that flew in the face of every major campaign in World War II, with the exception, perhaps, of the 1940 German campaign against France. The United States makes an interesting contrast to other nations. The first great conflict that the Americans waged as a major power came with the American Civil War. The problem that the North confronted was not just in mobilizing vast military power from a tiny garrison force whose mission had been to keep settlers and Indians separated, but also in fighting a war over continental distances, which would require logistical capabilities unheard of thus far in military history. The vast area of the Confederacy, some 780,000 square miles, was equivalent to the combined territories of Britain, France, the Low Countries, Spain, Germany, and Italy. The problem for the North, then, was not just to raise vast armies and mobilize its industry, which was almost completely unprepared to support the needs of a major war, but also to project military power over continental distances, distances that the Europeans had only confronted with Napoleon's invasion of Russia, and then none too successfully. The result was an emphasis on logistics, which has been at the center of U.S. military culture ever since. But then it has to be, because the capabilities of the American military depend on the ability to project power over continental and oceanic distances. Victory in the Pacific and in Europe represented the triumph of American military culture, in which an understanding of logistics was deeply embedded in its military approach to strategy as well as operations. If geography is important to the formation of the culture of military organizations, so too are the influences of past military experiences. In some cases, geography and the past are intimately intertwined. In this regard, the experience of Russia is instrumental. It has the greatest land expanse of any major nation, even after the collapse of the Soviet Union. However, unlike the United States, which has no major powers on its borders and has suffered invasions only when it had no significant navy, Russia, despite its vast spaces, has confronted a series of significant invasions, beginning with the Mongols in the 13th century, whose devastating conquest set Russian civilization far behind that of the rest of Europe. A number of major invasions from the West followed that disaster. The Poles in the 17th century, the Swedes in the 18th century, Napoleon and the Grand Army in 1812, and finally the Germans in World Wars I and II. The German invasion was the most terrible of all. By the time the Red Army had driven the Wehrmacht off the territory of the Soviet Union, some 27 million Soviet citizens had died. Not surprising, that historical experience has given the Russians a strategic culture driven by fear and suspicion of the outsider, and an expansionist mentality aiming to incorporate buffer states that lay along its borders, along with a deep suspicion of its neighbors that verges on the paranoid. For a specific historical example that underlines the impact of the past on military culture, there are few better examples than the disastrous defeat that the Prussian army suffered at the hands of Napoleon and his marshals in October 1806 at the double battles of Jena and Auerstadt. In one day, given grossly inept handling at the tactical and operational levels, the Prussian army collapsed before the Grand Army's onslaught. The collapse of the Prussian state followed soon thereafter. The result was that from the Napoleonic Wars onward, the Prussian officer corps focused heavily on tactics and military operations. It also developed a military culture that was profoundly anti-intellectual. By 1900, German military writers, largely influenced by the traditions of the Prussian army, were dismissing concepts of strategy. And even Clausewitz, with his emphasis on war as a continuation of politics by other means, as outmoded concepts not worthy of study. As General Geyer von Schweppenberg wrote to Little Hart after World War II, "You will be horrified to hear that I have never read Clausewitz or Delbruck or Haushofer." The opinion on Clausewitz in our general staff was that he was a theoretician to be read by professors. The emphasis was now on what the Germans termed military necessity. In such a strategic culture, the German general staff found it easy to dismiss the consequences of the fact that a violation of Belgium's neutrality during an invasion of France would bring Britain into the war. Similarly, military necessity overrode strategic and political concerns in the German decision to use poison gas in April 1915. Even more disastrous was the decision to resume submarine warfare against the British in January 1917, despite the fact that the Germans knew that doing so would bring the United States into the war. And indeed, the Americans did declare war in April 1917 with a strategic impact that sealed the Reich's fate. Underlining the overweening emphasis the Germans placed on tactics is the fact that in developing the plans for the Michel Offensive in March 1918, Ludendorff established no operational goals. As he told the Army Group Commander, Crown Prince Ruprecht of Bavaria, who was to command the offensive, "I object to the word operation. We will punch a hole in their line and see what turns up." The result was that the Germans conquered only territory that possessed neither strategic nor operational importance, and missed a significant chance to seize the main British supply dumps, thereby endangering the British position on the continent. The third of the great influences on the culture of military organizations has to do with the environment within which they operate. The nature of air power and the fact that aircraft can operate over substantial distances at great speeds provides airmen a freedom that their comrades on the ground and at sea do not possess. It has also created in air forces a highly technical and engineering culture in their approach to war. Moreover, the aircraft and the weapons air forces utilize have created a culture that rests on linear analysis, largely because so much of what air forces do in war and in peace can easily be reduced to statistics. Numbers of sorties flown, operational ready rates for aircraft and crews, bombs and tonnage of weapons dropped, availability of parts and munitions, and the number of enemy aircraft destroyed. The list of quantitative metrics for air forces is almost infinite. However, there is one great problem. These calculations have almost everything to do with efficiency and almost nothing to do with effectiveness. The first raid on the ball-bearing plants at Schweinfurt by the U.S. 8th Air Force underlines this reality in spades. The post-raid photographs indicated that the bombs had wrecked the roofs and walls of much of the factory areas, apparently a major success. But in fact, the wreckage of the factory's infrastructure did little damage to the machines that manufactured the ball bearings. The Germans were able then to pull those machines out from the wreckage in relatively undamaged condition and resume production. To sum up, one of the major difficulties in waging a successful air campaign has to do with the fact that in nearly every case, only post-war analysis can indicate how effective air strikes have been. Air Force's embrace of technology has also caused them to ignore historical realities, however short their histories have been. Strategic bombing culture in the interwar period held as an article of faith that bombers could reach their targets without fighter escort, despite applicable experience from German and Allied bombing campaigns in World War I. Despite even more relevant experience from the great bombing campaigns of World War II, airmen all too often believe that the latest technological gadgets will trump the experience of the past. One Air Force general, addressing a class at the U.S. Air War College after the first Gulf War, stated that due to the advent of guided munitions and stealth aircraft, any history before 1991 was irrelevant to air operations in the future. Of course, nothing could be further from the truth, but the anecdote illustrates how the embrace of technology can influence the culture of an organization. Navies, like air forces, confront the problem that they live in a potentially hostile environment. Although air forces have the choice of not flying when the weather is potentially too dangerous. Traditional naval culture has also found itself formed by the fact that once ships leave harbor, their captains have enjoyed the freedom of decision-making because their superiors have had no means of communicating with them. This has given naval captains the ability to take the initiative, but has also subjected them to strict accountability. If a captain runs his ship aground or crashes into another vessel, he is invariably relieved for cause. The inability of higher headquarters to communicate with vessels at sea had changed by the 1930s with increasingly effective radio communications. Nevertheless, the culture of captains displaying initiative was on display in the more effective navies of World War II, the U.S. Navy and the Royal Navy being prime examples. On the other hand, the conduct of the U-boat campaign by the Germans in that conflict witnessed Grand Admiral Dönitz attempting to run everything from shore to the general detriment of operations. The large amount of radio traffic involved created the conditions that allowed British code-breaking efforts to crack the U-boat Enigma ciphers, with a major impact on the conduct of the Battle of the Atlantic. Armies, however, confront a very different environment from that of navies and air forces. In war, they are almost always in contact with their enemy's ground forces. Moreover, they inevitably have to deal with civilians, not only their own, but, if they are on enemy ground, also those of their opponents. The combat framework is also quite different. In war, they confront the enemy directly in an environment of horror, slaughter, uncertainty, and ambiguity that reaches down to the lowest level. Unlike air forces and navies, commanders confront the reality that, as Clausewitz suggests, the lowliest private can disturb, divert, and even compromise the simplest plan. A battalion is made up of individuals, the least important of whom may chance to delay things or somehow make them go wrong. This makes an enormous difference in the cultures of armies and navies. The captain of an aircraft carrier can order his ship to make a 90-degree turn, and all 5,000 sailors will turn with the ship. For an infantry battalion, spread out over considerable ground, this quite simply is never going to be the case. Charismatic leadership, therefore, is valued more highly in army culture than in other services. In addition, the modern battlefield has expanded in distance, so armies have had to develop cultures that emphasize individual decision-making and initiative down to the lowest level. We should also note that each individual military organization has subcultures that differ in quite substantial ways from that of the larger organization of which they are a part. Those familiar with the U.S. Navy will quite readily recognize that it possesses three subcultures that differ in substantial ways: that of naval aviators, that of the surface navy, and that of the submariners. Moreover, history suggests that these subcultures will adapt to the realities of technological change in substantially different ways. During World War II, U.S. carriers, commanded by naval aviators, adapted to the introduction of radar quite successfully, a factor that played a major role in the American success at Midway. Only a few months later, surface admirals would prove oblivious to the advantage that radar could have provided their ships against the Japanese, who did not possess radar but were expert at night fighting. As a result, in three battles that occurred in the area surrounding Guadalcanal, the surface admirals preferred to use their eyeballs instead of radar, with a resulting heavy loss in U.S. ships. This volume is organized into four parts: a theory section, followed by sections on the organizational culture of armies, navies, and air forces. In the first theory chapter, Chapter 1, social scientists Leonard Wong and Stephen J. Garris introduce the 9 attributes of organizational culture developed by the Global Leadership and Organizational Behavior Effectiveness, Globe Research Program and apply them to military organizations. These attributes are performance orientation, future orientation, assertiveness, institutional collectivism, in-group collectivism, power distance, humane orientation, uncertainty avoidance, and gender egalitarianism. The editors invited other chapter authors to use the Globe attributes in their evaluation of organizational culture, but did not force them to do so. Nevertheless, the Globe attributes are included in the volume to help the reader understand the broader aspects of organizational culture. This may assist the reader in understanding organizational culture even in the chapters in which the framework is not used. In the second theory chapter, Chapter 2, anthropologist David Kilcullen discusses strategic culture, a related concept to organizational culture, first introduced by RAND researchers in 1977 in the context of strategic nuclear warfare. His findings have direct relevance to the following chapters on the organizational culture of armed services. The next 16 chapters examine the organizational cultures of 11 armies, in the case of the United States and Britain, their armies in different time periods, two navies, a Marine Corps, and two air forces. The editors believe the salient characteristics and dominant cultures of land, sea, and air services are distinct enough that grouping them thematically is the proper way to organize the volume. Sea and air services are much more reliant on technology than land forces are, and operate in media, water and air, that demand significant technical understanding and respect. On the other hand, land forces operate among people and in the urban areas in which they live. Service cultures are shaped accordingly. Most of the chapters focus on Western militaries, although chapters also deal with the Indian, Chapter 6, Imperial Japanese, Chapter 9, and Iraqi, Chapter 12 armies. But adding more non-Western case studies would likely require a second volume. We realize that we have left out some obvious cases, among them the French Army from 1871 to 1940, the Italian Army from 1914 to 1945, the Chinese National Army from 1928 to 1948, and the Imperial Japanese Navy. Given the inability to add more material due to the length of the volume, the editors ask for forbearance for their choices. The importance of culture on military organizations is as vital today as it has been at any other time in history. Everything that military organizations must perform in the pursuit of national security objectives ultimately rests on their cultural foundations. Organizational culture will shape how military organizations respond to the challenges confronting them today and that they will face in the years ahead. The accelerated rate of technological change alone requires military organizations to adapt in order to survive. But, as the experience of militaries during the industrial era has shown, their ability to do so is highly dependent on organizational cultures that are willing to accept a certain amount of risk and that study the past as well as the present. Not all do so to their detriment and potentially to their extinction. The difficulty is that changing military culture represents an extraordinarily difficult task that may require years, if not decades, to accomplish. Perhaps one of the most important enablers to changing military culture during peacetime is the emphasis that military organizations place on professional military education. For example, the contrast between the major emphasis the U.S. military placed on professional military education in the 1920s and 1930s stands in stark contrast to the current situation, with serious implications for the future and for the American military's ability to adapt to the unexpected. It is critical, then, to draw out the insights of history to enable military leaders and policymakers in the present to understand the cultural contexts in which their organizations function. This volume aims to achieve that goal. Part 1. Theoretical Frameworks. Chapter 1. Culture and Military Organizations. Leonard Wong and Stephen J. Garris. Explanations for the successes or failures of militaries in both war and peace have traditionally focused on key factors such as technology, leadership, personnel, training, or a combination of all of these. A more recent addition to the list of possible variables contributing to military effectiveness is the concept of culture, the sum collection of beliefs, values, attitudes, and learned behavior of a group of people. A military's culture provides the underlying foundation for decisions in strategy, planning, organization, training, and operations. For example, viewing culture as a contributing factor to military effectiveness would suggest that during the American Revolutionary War, the culture of the Continental Army influenced the fledgling army's success and failure on battlefields ranging from Ticonderoga to Trenton. Culture, as Raymond Williams has pointed out, however, is one of the two or three most complicated words in the English language. So while the culture of the Continental Army may have had an impact on its combat effectiveness, defining and subsequently analyzing that culture may prove difficult, simply because there are multiple levels of analysis of culture. In the case of the Continental Army, many of the troops coming from the New England colonies brought with them their societal culture. It was a culture, as Alexis de Tocqueville observed, from a democratic society containing neither lords nor common people. Unfortunately, this leveling spirit of New England egalitarianism often conflicted with the hierarchy and discipline critical to the maneuver and massed fires required of an 18th century army. Part of the eventual success of the Continental Army was George Washington's recognition of this aspect of societal culture and his subsequent and sometimes draconian measures to make the distinction between enlisted men and officers more pronounced. In addition to the culture at the societal level of analysis, there is also the influence of military culture. Militaries, regardless of the society they serve, tend to hold some variation of the values and attitudes common to most warriors. Duty, discipline, and selfless service are traits often shared by combatants on both sides of the battlefield. As Barbara Ehrenreich has noted, similarities in military culture often override differences in societal culture. The warrior looks out at the enemy and sees men who are, in crucial respects, recognizably like himself. They are warriors too, and whatever differences they may have, whatever long-standing reasons for hatred, they share the basic tenets of warriordom: a respect for courage, a willingness to stand by one's comrades no matter what, a bold indifference to death. Even when divided by race and vast cultural differences, enemies may admire each other for their conduct as warriors. To muddy the waters even more, political scientists studying international relations provide yet another cultural level of analysis via the concept of strategic culture. A 1977 RAND study examining Soviet reactions to possible U.S. limited nuclear operations defined strategic culture as the sum total of ideas, conditioned emotional responses, and patterns of habitual behavior that members of a national strategic community have acquired through instruction or imitation and share with each other. According to the study, strategic culture helps to explain how Soviet preoccupation with vulnerability and inferiority led to a fascination with strategies of unilateral damage limitation in the event that deterrence failed. The focus of the following chapters is not to examine culture at the societal, military, or strategic levels of analysis. Instead, the focus is on organizational culture. Specifically, the pattern of shared assumptions that an organization learns as it solves problems and that has worked well enough to be considered valid and is therefore taught to new members as the correct way to approach those problems. Of course, a military's organizational culture may share similarities with a more universal military culture or reflect aspects of a national strategic culture that is influenced by a larger societal culture. However, the organizational boundaries of a specific military may delimit its organizational culture. Unfortunately, the existence of subcultures often confounds assessing the impact of organizational culture on military performance. Because individuals tend to gravitate toward those similar to themselves, they also tend to become more cohesive with people they interact with more often. According to one organizational theorist, task interdependence, reporting relationships, and proximity bring members of the organization into contact with each other. This dependence and interaction serves as a catalyst to subgroup formation and results in the formation of subcultures. For example, while navies tend to have distinct cultures from those of armies or air forces, the naval aviation subculture is often quite different from the subcultures of the naval surface or naval submarine forces. In the U.S. Navy, they even wear different colored shoes. A naval culture clearly serves as a foundation for these subcultures. Yet any analysis of Navy culture, or the culture of any complex organization, should include the recognition of subcultures, how they relate to each other, and how they fit together to form the larger culture. A social psychologist instrumental in introducing the concept of organizational culture proposed that in order to effectively analyze the culture of an organization, it is necessary to examine three components: A, artifacts; B, beliefs and values; and C, underlying basic assumptions. Artifacts are the outer layer of a culture that we can see, feel, taste, or smell. These observable facets of a culture can include the design of an army's weaponry, the routine relationships between officers and enlisted, recruiting posters adorning a unit's walls, or even the layout of the barracks. While artifacts are the palpable evidence of a culture, they only reflect the culture, not define it. Beneath the artifacts, an organization's beliefs and values make up the next level of organizational culture. One can detect the espoused beliefs and values of an organization in official sources, such as organizational creeds, command philosophies, or doctrinal statements, as well as in unofficial sources, such as letters, speeches, or interviews. The stated values of an organization serve the normative function of providing guidance to organizational members concerning how to behave or react in key situations or times of uncertainty. While artifacts are the observable clues of a culture, an organization's values reveal more of the motivations and rationale of the organizational culture. Of course, an organization's stated values may not match its demonstrated values. In order to determine the values and beliefs that an organization actually puts into use, as opposed to merely espousing, it is necessary to look deeper into the next level of cultural analysis. Beneath an organization's beliefs and values is the third level of an organizational culture, the underlying basic assumptions. When certain beliefs and values lead to repeated success in addressing problems or dealing with situations, basic assumptions gradually form. The beliefs become taken for granted and shared by nearly all organizational members as the approved way of seeing the world and guiding action. This underlying consensus of unseen and usually unconscious assumptions affects the perceptions, thought processes, and behaviors of an organization. For example, it is a basic assumption of most Western militaries that, in addition to mission accomplishment, preserving the lives of their soldiers is paramount. For these militaries, it is inconceivable to develop a strategy that deliberately sends their soldiers to certain death. Other militaries, however, may not have cultures resting on that assumption, and therefore may unhesitatingly deploy suicide bombers. Edgar Schein proposes five basic assumptions that undergird organizational cultures. 1. Assumptions about external adaptation issues. 2. Assumptions about managing internal integration. 3. Assumptions about the nature of reality and truth. 4. Assumptions about the nature of time and space. And 5. Assumptions about human nature, activity, and relationships. While these assumptions are comprehensive, they can be somewhat abstract when used in a military context. For example, Schein states that a central assumption concerning the nature of human activity addresses one's basic orientation to life. What is the appropriate level of activity or passivity? At the organizational level, Schein offers, this assumption concerns questions such as what is work and what is play. The utility of this cultural dimension in analyzing organizations such as Google or Geico that are known for being fun places to work is clear. For an Army, Air Force, or Navy, however, the efficacy of such questions is not so apparent. A more relevant set of organizational culture assumptions comes from the work of Geert Hofstede and the follow-on Global Leadership and Organizational Behavior Effectiveness Globe Research Program. Although focused mainly at the societal level, both the Hofstede and Globe Research provide an empirically supported assessment of the dimensions that distinguish organizations and societies. Hofstede identified four cultural dimensions, aspects of a culture that one can measure relative to other cultures, by examining employee responses to survey questionnaires from IBM employees in 50 countries. The dimensions were power distance, collectivism versus individualism, femininity versus masculinity, and uncertainty avoidance. Hofstede later added another dimension that quantified long-term versus short-term orientation. During the 1990s, Robert House and a team of researchers extended Hofstede's work with the Globe Project. The Globe Project collected data from more than 17,000 middle managers in 951 organizations in telecommunications, food processing, and finance industries across 62 societies. These data produced a more nuanced understanding of underlying organizational cultural assumptions by using questionnaire responses from the middle managers aggregated to the societal and organizational levels of analysis. Using multiple quantitative and qualitative techniques, Globe researchers found the derived scales statistically and conceptually sound. The Globe methodology resulted in the identification of 9 major attributes of cultures that serve as good substitutes for the basic assumptions underlying Schein's notions of artifacts and values. These 9 dimensions of culture form the foundation of an organization's beliefs and values, which are subsequently reflected in cultural artifacts. The result is a useful framework for analyzing organizational cultures, especially when contrasting organizational cultures across societal boundaries. Of course, some may view a synthesis of multiple theoretical approaches to culture as heretical. Nevertheless, the 9 underlying Globe dimensions facilitate effective highlighting of the differences between militaries through a cultural lens. The 9 dimensions underlying an organization's values are summarized in the following table and are discussed. Globe dimensions of military organizational culture. Performance orientation, the degree to which a military encourages and rewards performance improvement and excellence. Future orientation, the extent to which a military engages in future-oriented behaviors, such as delaying gratification, planning, and investing in the future. Assertiveness, the degree to which a military encourages individuals to be confrontational and aggressive in relations with others. Institutional collectivism, the degree to which a military encourages and rewards the collective distribution of resources. In-group collectivism, the degree to which members of a military express pride, loyalty, and cohesiveness to their military. Power distance, the degree to which members of the military expect power to be distributed equally. Humane orientation, the degree to which a military encourages and rewards its members to be fair, altruistic, generous, caring, and kind to others. Uncertainty avoidance, the extent to which a military relies on procedures and rules to reduce the unpredictability of future events. Gender egalitarianism, the degree to which a military minimizes gender inequality. Performance orientation is the degree to which an organization encourages and rewards members for setting challenging goals, promoting innovation, and striving for excellence. Organizations and societies with high performance orientation place great value on education, learning, and exercising initiative. They are comfortable communicating explicitly and directly. Organizations with low performance orientation value social relations, loyalty, tradition, and seniority. They are comfortable with passivity and subtle, indirect communication. An example of a low performance orientation in a military organizational culture is the Red Army in the late 1930s, when paranoia over allegiance to Stalin, given the massive purges taking place, outweighed concerns for military capabilities. The People's Commissariat for Internal Affairs, NKVD, arrested Marshal M.N. Tukhachevsky, the Red Army's most innovative strategist, in May 1937 with seven other high-ranking generals, and accused him of conspiring with Nazi Germany to overthrow the Soviet regime. Tukhachevsky was tried in secret, found guilty, and shot. The subsequent purge during Stalin's Great Terror eliminated thousands of the Red Army's most experienced officers and reinforced the primacy of loyalty to Stalin at the expense of military innovation and initiative. Future orientation is the degree to which an organization encourages and rewards forward-looking behaviors, such as planning and delayed gratification. It is based on the extent to which organizational members believe their current actions will influence their future. Organizations with a culture of high future orientation have a strategic perspective and tend to be adaptive and flexible. Organizations with a low future orientation focus more on immediate survival and short-term accomplishments. They can be hesitant to explore new methods, since implementing novel ideas might be disruptive to current performance. A military that exhibited an organizational culture with a high future orientation was the post-World War I Reichswehr led by Hans von Siegt. Despite the severe restrictions imposed by the Versailles Treaty, for example, an army limited to 100,000 men, von Siegt had the foresight to reorganize the army into a competent, professional force capable of future expansion. His future vision of warfare led to the development of doctrine, tactics, organization, and training that served as the foundation for the Wehrmacht's victories in 1939 and 1940. Assertiveness is the degree to which organizational members are tough, dominant, and aggressive in their relations with others. Organizations with high assertiveness exhibit a can-do attitude, value direct and unambiguous communication, and are unafraid to voice their opinions. organizations with cultures characterized by low assertiveness prefer communicating indirectly, emphasizing saving face and value harmony rather than control over the environment. The pre-World War II Japanese military serves as a good example of a military exhibiting an organizational culture high in assertiveness. In the early 1940s, the decision by the Japanese government to go to war was not certain. The emperor wanted to avoid a conflict with the United States, and even Tojo, the new prime minister, proposed negotiating accommodations to escape war. But as Ian Kershaw points out, the chiefs of the general staffs of both armed services, urged on by gung-ho middle echelon officers in their planning and operational sections, were the most forceful and outspoken advocates of war. By the late summer of 1941, they had pushed through, against no serious opposition, a commitment to military action before the end of the year. Institutional collectivism is the degree to which an organization practices, encourages, and rewards the collective distribution of resources and action. An organization with high levels of institutional collectivism will emphasize the importance of subjugating wants and desires for the greater good of the organization. An organization low in institutional collectivism will foster an emphasis on individualism and independence, and will cater to the needs of individual organizational members or subordinate units. An example of a military plagued by a culture low in institutional collectivism is the U.S. military of the early 1980s. With each service subculture looking out for its own interests, the disunity of the U.S. military was evident in highly visible events, such as the failed hostage rescue mission in Tehran and the tragedy of the Beirut Marine Barracks bombing. By the early 1980s, as one observer has pointed out, the services wielded their influence more to protect their independence and prerogatives than to develop multi-service commands capable of waging modern warfare. The subsequent military reforms of the Goldwater-Nichols Act of 1986 were a result of congressional dissatisfaction with an American military plagued by a culture of low institutional collectivism. In-group collectivism reflects the degree to which individuals express pride, loyalty, and cohesiveness in their organization. Organizations with high in-group collectivism pay homage to their lineage, extol the privilege of organizational membership, and enjoy strong bonds between organizational members. Organizations with cultures of low in-group collectivism are more impersonal, as connections between organizational members are weak or purely transactional. In-group collectivism in the military is often manifested as unit cohesion, esprit, or pride. It is a sine qua non for military excellence. It was a key factor in the formation of British commando units in the fall of 1940, the creation of U.S. Army Ranger and Airborne units in 1942, and the establishment of the Green Berets in the 1950s. Of course, not all militaries have cultures with high levels of in-group collectivism. For example, a key factor in the success of the American 2003 invasion of Iraq was the disintegration of the Iraqi army, including mass surrenders and defections. Captured Iraqi regular army soldiers reported that their decision to surrender was easily made because their loyalties and emotional ties were stronger to their tribe than to their unit. Rather than being motivated by the desire to not let their comrades down, Iraqi regular army soldiers reported that they were driven by fear of retribution by the Ba'ath Party or Fatayim Saddam if they were found avoiding combat. Power distance is the degree to which an organization is comfortable with the unequal distribution of power. High power distance cultures accept large differences in power among the various levels of a hierarchy, while low power distance cultures expect a lower level of power differential. Organizations with a high power distance culture encourage subordinates to rely on the judgment of superiors and proffer respect to those in higher ranks. Militaries tend to have organizational cultures with high power distance, as deference to those higher in rank is often viewed as a prerequisite to a military organization. Nevertheless, some militaries have deliberately tried to change the power distance dimension of organizational culture. For example, in an effort to promote closer relations between officers and enlisted soldiers, as well as eliminating the rampant abuse of rank, Mao Zedong abolished all military ranks in the People's Liberation Army, PLA, in 1965. Military reforms and a renewed focus on combat effectiveness, however, led to the eventual restoration of ranks in the PLA in the mid-1980s. Humane orientation is the degree to which an organization encourages and rewards individuals for being fair, altruistic, generous, and caring. An organization with a high humane orientation promotes the well-being of others, while the promotion of self-interest and a lack of consideration of others characterize a culture with a low humane orientation. It seems unlikely that militaries with the primary mission of fighting their nation's wars would have a culture marked by a high humane orientation. After all, altruistic and caring are not typical descriptors of most armies. And yet, modern militaries have been increasingly thrust into a humanitarian role due to famines, earthquakes, civil wars, and tsunamis. Critics, however, question if mere participation in humanitarian missions truly reflects a humane orientation in a military's culture. The executive director of Doctors Without Borders has noted that it is simply not possible for a government or military to have the unconditional ambition of only providing humanitarian action. We recognize that aid supplied by military forces can provide relief to people in need, as can acts of assistance undertaken by individual soldiers or units moved by a sense of humanity. But this aid is different. It is not humanitarian assistance. It is given to reward, and it can be withheld to punish. Uncertainty avoidance addresses the extent to which organizational members are comfortable with change and ambiguity. Organizational cultures with high uncertainty avoidance seek consistency, structure, and formalized procedures. They tend to be less tolerant of rule-breaking and seek to minimize risk. Cultures with low uncertainty avoidance are comfortable with risk, experimentation, and innovation. While all militaries struggle with the competing tasks of maintaining predictability while embracing uncertainty, the U.S. Army in the late 1990s exhibited a culture marked by high uncertainty avoidance. The lingering effects of training against a predictable Soviet threat, combined with templated mission rehearsal exercises, MREs for peacekeeping operations, led to a culture where leader development resulted mainly from scripted, formalized training. The resulting culture was, as a U.S. Army War College study has pointed out, marked by reactive instead of proactive thought, compliance instead of creativity, and adherence instead of audacity. Junior officers, especially company commanders, were seldom given opportunities to be innovative, to make decisions, or to fail, learn, and try again. Gender egalitarianism is the degree to which an organization treats both genders equally. An organization with a high level of gender egalitarianism will have many women in positions of authority, accord them higher status, and give them a greater role in decision-making. Militaries, of course, tend to be masculine organizations, and thus one might conclude that analysis in this dimension of culture will yield little insight. Recent research on the role of militaries in peacekeeping operations, however, may suggest otherwise. The recent increase in deployments of United Nations peacekeepers throughout the world has resulted in the unintended consequence of sexual exploitation and abuse committed by peacekeepers on local populations. Human trafficking, prostitution, and sex with minors appear to be disturbing byproducts of militaries participating in peacekeeping operations. Interestingly, analysis of mission-level information from 2009 to 2013 shows that units with personnel from countries with better records of gender equality and units with higher proportions of female peacekeepers possess lower levels of sexual exploitation and abuse allegations. The nine globe dimensions provide a useful framework to analyze a military's organizational culture. Analysis of an organization's culture, however, does not reveal if it is good or bad, right or wrong. Instead, a cultural analysis examines if an organization's culture is properly aligned to its mission and environment. For example, concerning in-group collectivism, it would seem unusual to imagine a mission or environment where a military culture of pride, loyalty, and cohesiveness would not be appropriate. But in-group collectivism can occasionally encourage acts of subversion and rebellion when members believe that group norms will provide anonymity and protection from external authority. The Canadian Airborne Regiment, participating in the United Nations humanitarian mission in Somalia in 1992 to 1993, suffered from in-group collectivism gone awry, as the bonds between unit members became a dysfunctional part of a misaligned culture. After a series of scandalous events, culminating in the beating death of a Somali teenager and a subsequent cover-up, the Canadian Army disbanded the entire regiment in 1995. As one commentator has concluded in her post-mortem analysis of the regiment, group bonding is a double-edged sword. What can be functional unit bonding for war can quickly become dysfunctional in an army at peace. The beliefs, values, and assumptions comprising an organization's culture, regardless if it is aligned or misaligned, are emplaced and perpetuated largely through the actions of organizational leaders. Shine categorizes these actions as primary embedding mechanisms and secondary reinforcement and stabilizing mechanisms. While these actions play a large role in the genesis and sustainment of an organizational culture, they are also visible artifacts of that culture. Thus, primary embedding and secondary reinforcing mechanisms serve both prescriptive and descriptive roles in the analysis of organizational cultures. They are prescriptive because they are actions that leaders can take if they want to realign a culture. They are descriptive because they are evidence of the assumptions, values, and beliefs held by an organization. Shine proposes six primary embedding mechanisms that leaders can use to teach their organizations how to perceive, think, feel, and behave based on their conscious and unconscious convictions. Primary embedding mechanisms have a direct role in instilling values and assumptions into the culture. While reinforcing mechanisms are often easier to execute, it is embedding mechanisms that give the culture direction and meaning. When leaders are personally involved and engaged, organizational members consciously and subconsciously learn what is truly important to the organization. Primary embedding mechanisms. What leaders pay attention to, measure, and control on a regular basis. How leaders react to critical incidents and organizational crises. Observed criteria by which leaders allocate scarce resources. Deliberate role modeling, teaching, and coaching. Observed criteria by which leaders recruit, select, promote, retire, and excommunicate organizational members. Observed criteria by which leaders allocate rewards and status. An instructive example of the use of primary embedding mechanisms to affect cultural change lies in the actions of General Maxwell Thurman in the early days of the American All-Volunteer Army. The U.S. military draft had ended in 1973. But less than a decade later, the viability of the all-volunteer force was in jeopardy. The chorus of complaints concerning the readiness and quality of the force had reached such a volume that many supporters began second-guessing the wisdom of abolishing the draft. Even former President Richard Nixon, who had introduced the all-volunteer army during his campaign for the presidency, wrote in 1980, "I considered the end of the draft in 1973 to be one of the major achievements of my administration. Now, 7 years later, I have reluctantly concluded that we should reintroduce the draft." In November 1979, with just 2 weeks' notice, the Army's Chief of Staff, General Edward Meyer, informed Major General Thurman that he was to take over and transform the struggling Army recruiting command. The most potent embedding mechanism available for communicating what leaders believe is important or unimportant is what leaders systematically pay attention to, monitor, or control on a regular basis. The key to this embedding mechanism is that the action must be systematic. The interest need not be substantial, but it must be consistent. Prior to Thurman taking over the recruiting command, the most important number to an Army recruiter was the mission quota, the number of new soldiers that had to be brought on board. Thurman wanted to change that approach and set out to emphasize quality over quantity. Empirical studies had shown that high-quality soldiers, those with a high school diploma and scoring above the 50th percentile in mental aptitude, were more likely to complete their enlistments, have fewer instances of indiscipline, and perform better in training. Thurman directed that each recruiter, as well as his battalion and brigade commander, carry his mission box, a card specifying not only his monthly targeted number of recruits, but also the quality parameters for each recruit. It became clear to everyone in recruiting command that quality was the goal, not quantity. Thurman's focus on quality soldiers, supported by his continuous monitoring of quality metrics, resulted in demonstrable change. In fiscal year 1980, 54% of new recruits had graduated from high school. By 1987, 91% were high school graduates. By 1992, only 2% of new soldiers did not have a high school diploma. Shine posits a second embedding mechanism: how leaders react to critical incidents and organizational crises. During a time of crisis, anxiety and emotional intensity bring about a heightened sense of learning. The reaction of leaders in dealing with a crisis transmits organizational values that later guide behavior. In the case of the all-volunteer Army, it was discovered in 1979 that the Armed Services Vocational Aptitude Battery, ASVAB, was misnormed and was mistakenly allowing thousands of low-quality personnel into the armed forces. The ASVAB was eventually renormed and a new test was created. Each of the services, however, had to decide what to do with a large pool of candidates whom the old test had deemed qualified, but who were now disqualified as low quality by the correctly normed test. The decision was critical, as thousands of potential recruits were no longer eligible for enlistment according to the new test. The Navy reacted by lowering its enlistment standards and permitted about 95% of the misnormed, low mental aptitude population to enlist. The Army, under Thurman's orders, continued to uphold standards and focused on recruiting high school graduates scoring above the 50th percentile in mental aptitude. Even though Army recruiters had to scramble to make up the shortfall in numbers, Thurman wanted no part of the unqualified population. Another embedding mechanism is how leaders allocate scarce resources. Budgets, rather than rhetoric, reveal a leader's true priorities. Thurman, encouraged by sociologist Charlie Moskos, was an ardent advocate of a dual-market recruiting strategy. Studies showed that young people potentially interested in joining the Army were generally work-oriented or college-oriented. Higher pay and training appealed to those in the former group who viewed the Army as a means to learn a skill. The latter group, however, was attracted to deferred incentives, especially money to attend college. Attracting high-quality, college-bound youth with educational benefits, however, required congressional support for a substantial amount of funding. As a result, Thurman worked closely with Representative Sonny Montgomery to get the GI Bill signed into law in 1984. Despite resistance from both the Office of the Secretary of Defense and the Office of Management and Budget. Deliberate role modeling, teaching, and coaching is a primary embedding mechanism that communicates organizational values and assumptions through the visible behavior of leaders. Thurman realized that part of the struggle in recruiting quality soldiers was the lack of ownership in many parts of recruiting command. He found layers of the bureaucracy merely relaying information without thoroughly comprehending the difficulties and effort involved in recruiting a soldier. For example, a few weeks after taking command, he noticed that leaders, especially the officers in recruiting command, were isolated from the complexities of the recruiting process experienced by the non-commissioned officers, NCOs, serving as recruiters. Officers were content to manage the process, but often deferred to the NCOs due to a lack of knowledge of the gritty details of recruiting. To eliminate their disengagement from the recruiting process, Thurman mandated that every officer in recruiting command had 60 days to personally recruit a soldier. He also instituted mission adjudication, quarterly face-to-face meetings between himself and each of his 57 recruiting battalion commanders, to specify the quality and numbers of individuals to be recruited. Thurman ensured that the process carried down to the recruiter level and that everyone understood the situation. By involving leaders in the critical aspects of recruiting, he was able to send to the entire command an unmistakable message concerning organizational priorities. A more subtle embedding mechanism is the criteria by which leaders select, promote, and separate organizational members. Thurman firmly believed that the caliber of his recruiting NCOs was critical in attracting quality youth, especially for the combat arms. He maintained that the Army's most visible representatives to American society needed to reflect the high-quality soldiers they were trying to recruit. Unfortunately, high-quality combat arms NCOs were not volunteering for duty in recruiting command. At the time, there was an NCO shortage across the Army, especially in Europe. Combat arms NCOs were spending 3 years in units in Germany and then rotating back to the United States for a year before getting orders for another tour in Europe. Instead of getting high-quality combat arms NCOs to volunteer for recruiting command, it became obvious that recruiting duty was attracting NCOs who were A. avoiding another Germany tour, or B. looking for an easy job. Thurman corrected the situation with a simple directive. NCOs could no longer volunteer to serve in recruiting command. Instead, the Army now selected the best NCOs for a 3-year tour as a recruiter and then returned them to the force for the remainder of their careers. The policy, according to Thurman, was essentially saying to NCOs who wanted to be recruiters, come and serve in the recruiting command for 3 years, and then you will get a chance to serve with the people you recruited. Therefore, don't bring us scumbags. Bring us only high-quality people. Another primary embedding mechanism is the observed criteria by which leaders allocate rewards and status. Organizational values are transmitted when certain actions or activities receive prestige or honor. For example, Thurman was a strong believer of ensuring policies were supported by empirical analysis. As a result, he relied heavily on the analytical capabilities of 4 organizations. The first 3 were RAND, a federally funded research and development center. NW Air, the advertising agency, awarded the Army contract for recruiting ads, and the Army Research Institute, ARI, an organization of mostly psychologists and sociologists. But he also stood up the Office of Economic and Manpower Analysis, OEMA, at the U.S. Military Academy, and had it report directly to him to serve as a counterweight to the RAND analysis. Direct access to Thurman by each research cell reflected the preeminence of empirically based policy formulation during his tenure. Once primary embedding mechanisms begin emplacing assumptions and values into an organization's culture, secondary reinforcement and stabilizing mechanisms can support and buttress the emerging culture. In order for reinforcing mechanisms to be effective, however, they must be consistent with the organizational beliefs and values transmitted by the primary embedding mechanisms. Shine offers 6 secondary reinforcement and stabilizing mechanisms. Secondary reinforcement and stabilizing mechanisms. Organizational systems and procedures, organizational design and structure, design of physical space, facades, and buildings, formal statements of organizational philosophy, creeds, and charters, organizational rites and rituals, stories, legends, and myths about people and events. Each reinforcing mechanism is fairly easy to understand and execute compared to the more complex primary embedding mechanisms, which is why leaders sometimes mistakenly rely on reinforcing mechanisms instead of embedding mechanisms to analyze or change a culture. Reinforcing mechanisms alone do not reflect or change a culture. Instead, reinforcing mechanisms only serve in a supporting role to the more difficult and leader-centric work of primary embedding mechanisms. Likewise, reinforcing mechanisms often appear to be obvious cultural artifacts, since they tend to be more tangible and well-documented than embedding mechanisms. An organization's culture, however, is reflected more in what leaders demonstrate through their behavior than what is written down or inferred from visible structures, systems, rituals, stories, or published doctrine. Secondary reinforcing and stabilizing mechanisms played a key role in transforming the American draft army organizational culture to one aligned with the notion of a high-quality, all-volunteer army. A number of factors facilitated the effectiveness of the reinforcing mechanisms, especially the continuous oversight of the all-volunteer force as the Army promoted Thurman from Commanding General of Recruiting Command to become Deputy Chief of Staff Personnel and then the U.S. Army Vice Chief of Staff. The extraordinary success of the advertising campaign slogan, "Be All You Can Be," underlined the rebound of the all-volunteer Army after the near failure in the 1970s. The slogan eventually pushed the Army into one of the most recognizable brands in America. But more important, the slogan was attractive to both potential recruits and serving soldiers. Be All You Can Be represented the nascent professional Army of the 1980s, a far cry from the Today's Army Wants to Join You slogan of the early 1970s. Thurman realized, however, that bringing in high-quality soldiers was only the first step to transforming the Army. If soldiers were recruited in hopes of being all they could be, it was imperative that the Army deliver on that promise. It was during this era that the Army began introducing changes in organizational systems and procedures, such as the training revolution that focused on more deliberate planning, measurable outcomes, and continual evaluation. The renewed emphasis on training culminated in new organizational design and structures, such as the establishment of the National Training Center at Fort Irwin, California. With more than 1,000 square miles, 2,590 square kilometers, for maneuvering large units and operating ranges, an unrestricted electromagnetic spectrum, open airspace for military use and isolation from the local populace, Fort Irwin became the model for large-scale, force-on-force instrumented training. In addition to the transformed emphasis on training, the Army introduced much-needed improvements to key acquisition programs. The Big Five weapons system programs were initiated in the 1970s, but arrived in the 1980s to a force desperate for modernization. the Abrams main battle tank, Bradley infantry fighting vehicle, Patriot missile system, Black Hawk helicopter, and Apache attack helicopter gave the Army a much improved combat capability that helped fuel the increasing professionalism of the force. The all-volunteer Army had marketed itself as an increasingly high-tech organization, and the introduction of the Big Five weapon systems confirmed that claim. By the early 1980s, the Army realized that a key component to retaining high-quality NCOs and officers in an all-volunteer force was their families. Recognizing that the design of physical space could support the cultural change sweeping through the force, Army posts underwent extensive renovation as part of the emphasis on improving the living and working conditions for soldiers and their families. In 1983, funding for family housing increased 57%, due largely to an additional $74 million in the housing budget. In that same year, the Army signed the Army Family White Paper, which was a formal statement of organizational philosophy expressing the Army's commitment to wellness and the sense of community within the Army. The renewed attention on the families and the emphasis on raising the overall quality of life for soldiers were part of a gradual departure from a conscription-based belief that soldiers were a free good. The draft had created an organizational culture that valued the service of soldiers, yet the Army acted as if soldiers were replaceable at zero cost. From senior leaders to drill sergeants, a gradual realization emerged that if soldiers did not feel valued or respected, especially the high-quality troops, they would leave. The all-volunteer force required a realignment of the Army's organizational culture that was accomplished through the leader-centric actions of primary embedding mechanisms and then supported by secondary reinforcing and stabilizing mechanisms. This chapter has presented a framework to understand and assess organizational culture. Comprehending the deep assumptions that influence the decision-making logic for most human behaviors in a large, complex organization whose main purpose is to kill its nation's foes is a messy endeavor full of inferences, contradictions, and inconsistencies. Few take on this task. Yet the efficacy of having an organizational culture aligned with the challenges of the organization's mission and environment may be the most underrated variable in war and strategy. Chapter 2, Strategic Culture, David Kilcullen. In May 2011, as the Arab Spring roiled the Middle East and America and its allies intervened in Libya and continued their surge in Afghanistan, I was teaching at the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO Defense College, in Rome. In my group of 12 students, alongside U.S. military leaders, were European officers from all services and an army officer from the Russian Federation. I asked what the group thought of the ongoing cascade of revolutions and what role NATO military forces should or should not play in stabilizing the situation. To a man, they were all men, the Western Europeans shook their heads and spoke of overstretch, too many troops in Afghanistan, resources strained by the 2008 global financial crisis, publics weary of conflict and unsure of the purpose of involvement. Was dealing with revolution in Africa and Arabia really an appropriate role for Europe's militaries? The age of empire was over, after all. Eastern European students, on average, framed the situation differently. Not as an optional out-of-area operation like Afghanistan, but as a mandatory defensive action to stabilize NATO's southern flank and defend Europe from external threat. I saw one American officer roll his eyes slightly, perhaps contrasting European weariness over Afghanistan with his country's much larger effort in Iraq, Afghanistan, and the broader war on terror, a war to protect the very Western civilizational order that its inheritors seemed reluctant to defend. but the strongest reaction was from the Russian officer. Our visitor looked slowly around the room and then said, "I was a Soviet officer in the Cold War. Back then, we thought NATO was like this." He raised a clenched fist on an erect forearm. "But now I realize it is like this," and let his arm droop flaccidly to the table. National stereotypes were all too clearly on display in this conversation. Western Europeans, languid and scarred by post-colonial guilt. Americans carrying the burden for their allies, the New World saving the Old World once again, with a combined sense of resignation, entitlement, and pride. Eastern Europeans determined to defend a civilizational frontier against the barbarians at the gate, and a Russian seeing military power as a crudely sexual contest of manly prowess. If this seems like a cliché-driven joke, an American, a European, and a Russian officer walk into a bar, it might be because such stereotypes, though clearly reductionist, do contain a kernel of truth about the nations they depict and the way political leaders and military commanders view the use of force. Organizational versus strategic culture. In a broad sense, that is to say, purely as a matter of statistical averages and despite a wide range of individual differences, members of ethnic groups demonstrably hold similar, unspoken assumptions about what is normal, share expectations as to what is or is not appropriate, and adopt common framing constructs, ways of categorizing events, to make sense of their experience. Like the fish in David Foster Wallace's This Is Water, an older fish asks two youngsters how the water is today, and after a pause, one of the younger ones turns to the other and asks, "What the hell is water?" Such perceptual frameworks and pervasive assumptions may be so unexamined that group members are unaware of their existence. We call this phenomenon of shared sense-making and norm creation within an ethnic group culture. Or, rather, this is one of many things for which English speakers confusingly use that term. In a book on military organizational culture, the relevance of such norms seems axiomatic. Recruits to military organizations are acculturated through tools like boot camp, barracks life, training exercises, and war colleges into common ways of perceiving the world, shared frameworks for making sense of it, and similar purpose-driven teleological behaviors, many unconscious, that support the organization's reason for being. At the operational level of war, the apotheosis of this approach was the great German general staff of the 19th and early 20th centuries, with its notion that any officer schooled from earliest adulthood in a particular way of thinking and internalizing a single cultural outlook would, if confronted by a given set of circumstances, interpret them in an identical manner to reach a staff solution that his peers would recognize as correct. One officer could, ideally, predict the decision another would reach, provided he knew the situation his peer faced. At the tactical level, the Imperial German system of mission command, Auftragstaktik, was grounded in this notion. Subordinates could be implicitly trusted to execute missions without oversight, or chiefs of staff to issue orders in the name of the commander without checking first, precisely because their superiors could count on them to interpret situations in a predictable manner. The trust engendered by common culture meant orders could be abbreviated to the absolute minimum, enabling the rapid maneuver and decentralized command required by infiltration tactics, famously illustrated by the storm troop commander captured on the first day of Germany's 1918 spring offensive, who revealed under interrogation that his orders were simply the further, the better. He had penetrated as far as the British Brigade headquarters, part of the biggest breakthrough of the entire war until the Australians and Americans broke the Hindenburg line 6 months later. Americans returning from World War I criticized this theory of a composite directive mind, a theoretical single mind composed of a general and a selected group of staff officers, arguing in overtly ethnic terms that this approach is German, is discredited by the German debacle, and the results require no comment. But by the 1980s, beginning in the U.S. Marine Corps and spreading first to the U.S. Army and then to other services and allied militaries, an appreciation of mission-type command and directive control, the foundations of maneuver warfare, spread through the armed services. Some ridiculed the Germanophile tendencies of a force that had defeated the Germans twice in a generation, while others critiqued the hive mind that seemed to result as the expression of a particular organizational culture. Yet the advantages of this approach, from the 100-hour war in the Gulf in 1991 to the rapid overthrow of Saddam Hussein in 2003, soon became clear. Its disadvantages took longer to emerge. But the term strategic culture usually denotes something different from and more contested than military organizational culture. The notion of strategic culture typically refers to nationally or ethnically defined rather than institutionally modulated cultural norms. Individuals and subgroups within ethnic groups are presumed to self-ascribe to a certain identity, absorb distinctive attitudes about the use of force, and thus adopt a national way of war, whatever their institutional home and despite their organizational differences. For example, American flyers, sailors, soldiers, and Marines all exhibit subtly different organizational cultures. In Afghanistan, we used to say, Army are campers, Marines are hikers, as a way of getting at these differences. But at a broader national level, all Americans, irrespective of service, or indeed whether they are service members or civilian decision makers, are presumed to share a strategic culture, an American way of war that influences how situations are interpreted and decisions are made. Attitudes, norms, and expectations around the use of force in defense of family, clan, tribe, or nation are fundamental to social organization. Indeed, anthropologist Harry Turney High suggested in 1981 that the organization of all known societies has been so heavily influenced since earliest antiquity by the need to prepare for and conduct organized violence against other human social groups that warfare is social organization. Likewise, historian Philip Bobbitt considers warfare one of three key influencers, along with law and commerce, on the shape of the state through history. Lawrence Keeley, another anthropologist, argues that a society's demography, economy, and social system provide the means for and impose limits on military technique. As I wrote in an earlier book, if we accept this, along with the fact that war has been endemic in roughly 95% of all known human societies throughout history and prehistory, it follows that warfare is a central and probably a permanent human social institution. Given the centrality, and more important, the utter normality of war in virtually all known societies, it would be surprising indeed if the same factors that give rise to distinct cultures within ethnic groups did not also create national strategic cultures. Strategic culture precedes organizational culture. Organizational and ethnic cultures coexist, of course, in any one military unit, and there may be multiple subcultures. Snipers, drone operators, and EOD personnel, for example, are famous for their clannishness, and every rifle company believes itself uniquely different from and better than every other. But more than this, strategic culture, since it derives from enduring ethnic and national characteristics, precedes and supersedes organizational culture. An incident from Somalia illustrates this. In mid-2012, I had the opportunity to accompany a battalion of the Somali National Army, SNA, during operations against the jihadist group Al-Shabaab around Afgoya, a town in the lower Shabelle River Valley, about 15 miles, an hour's drive in normal times, but 6 months hard fighting in 2012, from Somalia's capital city, Mogadishu. This particular unit had been recruited from members of warlord Mohammed Farah Adid's Somali National Alliance, who fought Task Force Ranger in the 1993 Battle of Mogadishu, depicted in the bookend film Black Hawk Down. As such, this battalion fought according to traditional informal norms, folkways of warfare, that they had learned on the job over more than two decades of fighting. I have described their dynamic swarm tactics elsewhere, but the culture underpinning these tactics is worth noting. As I wrote at the time, any professional soldier in the world would be proud to command troops with this kind of tactical initiative. Indeed, I found only one slight issue on which to fault the SNA tactics: the fact that the squad leader stayed in the vehicle while his troops dismounted to assault. Western tactics would call for the leader to dismount with the troops, carrying a radio to talk back to the vehicle and direct its fire, and leaving a trusted subordinate as vehicle commander to maneuver the gun truck. But as soon as this thought entered my head, I realized I was looking at the Somali squad in completely the wrong way. I was misapplying the social and economic framework of a professional state-run military to an organization that had evolved from an irregular militia. In the Somali environment of fragmented, semi-anarchic clan organizations in which these tactics had emerged, the way someone became a squad leader in the first place was to own the armed SUV known as a technical, an extremely substantial piece of capital equipment. The squad leader became the squad leader precisely because it was his vehicle. So it would have been the height of stupidity for him to dismount and thereby cede control of the gun truck to someone else, let alone to leave someone behind him with a machine gun. He might not have remained the squad leader for long. Moreover, dismounted fighters are cheap and replaceable, but the vehicle is a precious investment that is decidedly not expendable. Seen from this perspective, the SNA's mounted swarm tactics have, like any tactical system, an economic, political, and social logic, as well as a military grammar. Here we see a strategic culture, the way of war and combat style of a clan-based non-state militia, influencing the organizational culture of a national military unit a generation later, with ethnic and historical factors setting the cultural parameters within which organizational culture and individual initiative operate. In this case, as in other examples, strategic culture can be clearly seen to precede and shape military organizational culture. We ignore this culture at our peril, particularly in situations like Afghanistan, Libya, Iraq, or Somalia, where Western trainers and advisors work with indigenous forces. Books have been written on the tendency of U.S. advisors to produce partner military forces in their own image, generating local military allies burdened with lavish equipment but systematically stripped of their naturally acquired ways of war, of the sort these Somalis clearly retained. In fact, this critique could be made of almost any military force in foreign internal defense, FID, or security force assistance, or indeed of any intervening outsider in a crisis situation, including non-governmental organizations and aid agencies in development and humanitarian programs, so that it is less a U.S. military failing than a generic problem. Still, imagine how different today's Afghan army, for example, would look if, instead of taking a group that knew how to fight, had been fighting the Taliban for a decade, and had a self-organizing tactical system superbly adapted to its own environment and giving it complicated heavy weapons, vehicles that bound it to roads, and an enduring dependence on Western air support, we had left its fighting style as undisturbed as possible, while inserting niche capabilities only and improving human capital through education, healthcare, ethics, and civics programs led by Afghans. To even verbalize such a fantasy is to tag myself as a member of a particular tribe within the Western way of war, of course. But the key point is that ethnic culture frames strategic culture, that subset of culture dealing with the use of force, which in turn interacts with organizational structure, institutional form, and individual incentives to create military organizational culture. Subnational strategic cultures. It is worth noting that the strategic culture at play in the Somali example is not national but subnational, relating to a regionally prominent subclan, the Habar Gadir of the Hawiya clan, which dominates the Mogadishu region. The existence of subnational strategic cultures is largely absent from the literature on comparative strategic culture, which tends to focus at the national level, yet is readily observable. Within the British Raj, for example, colonial administrators in India after 1857 overtly designated some ethnic groups as martial races and others as non-martial. Martial races included Sikhs, Gurkhas, Baluch, Pathans, Pashtuns, and Rajputs, ethnic groups whose outlook, religion, material culture, and regional environments were deemed, by British officials but also by these groups themselves and by others, to confer a particular aptitude for warfare. It is worth pointing out that the imputation of military skills to racial rather than ethnic characteristics was common among administrators and scholars alike up until the mid-20th century. Many members of the so-called martial races ended up in Pakistan after partition in 1947. Arguably, by internalizing a racialized self-ascription of military prowess and denigrating as non-martial the ethnic groups that mostly found themselves in India after 1947, Pakistanis went into the Indo-Pakistan conflicts of 1965 and 1971 with unjustified confidence in their ability to defeat numerically superior Indian and Bangladeshi forces. In Africa and Australasia, similar racialized notions of military prowess were at work during the British Empire. For British colonial administrators, Zulus, Maori, Dayaks, and Matabele were martial, while Australian Aborigines, Chinese coolies, and Egyptian fellaheen were not. Even at home in the British Isles, imperial administrators designated some ethnic groups, in particular Scots Highlanders and Ulstermen, as believed to possess a biological or cultural disposition to the racial and masculine qualities necessary for the arts of war. Likewise, Scots Irish immigrants to the United States were described as born fighting and having a higher participation rate in America's wars. In the American case, these immigrants have been variously believed to have inherited martial characteristics from their Scottish and Irish forebears, perhaps a spillover from the 19th century British stereotype, to maintain greater military skill because of the harsh mountain environment of Appalachia, where many settled, or to have been motivated to join the service by a culture of honor and by bitter hardship after the Confederacy's defeat in the American Civil War. The same environmental determinism, hardy mountain tribes fighting off invaders, was applied to other ethnic groups in different contexts. Think of Albanians, Kurds, and Pashtuns, while honor culture is believed by some Hispanics to account for their overrepresentation in the Marine Corps and in combat units generally. Thus, even in nation-state military forces or imperial domains like the British or Ottoman empires, subnational, regional, or ethnic cultures can impact strategic culture at the national level, as well as influencing military organizational culture by helping shape self-identity. As an exchange officer with the British Army in the 1990s, I was struck by the thoroughly English Lowlands origins of many officers in Scottish Highland regiments, and yet, at the same time, by how thoroughly they had absorbed a conception of themselves as Highlanders. Indeed, to borrow a term from feminist theory, an individual within a given armed service may experience a high degree of intersectionality, where national and subnational strategic culture, ethnicity and gender identity, biological factors such as race and sex, unit or formation-level organizational cultures, and niche subcultures overlap. Anthropologists speak of multivalent and contingent identities as a way to explain how individuals and groups react to these cultural, genetic, and environmental overlaps. Actual data on Hispanic and Scots-Irish participation rates in combat units, let alone on the combat performance of martial versus non-martial ethnic groups, are far more complex than this discussion would suggest, a fact that highlights another element of strategic culture and of culture generally, that identity may be based on fictive, imagined kinship with related groups or on self-conceptions that may be remarkably at variance from observable fact. As for the Highland Regiment officers just mentioned, these fictive aspects of identity may in turn become elements of a national myth that influences national-level strategic culture. This is perhaps the case in the Pakistani example noted earlier. But an even more prominent instance is that of Australia's Anzac legend, partly founded on the belief that the country's all-volunteer force in World War I was mostly drawn from hardy, rural, outdoorsy stock, whose physical fitness and ability to shoot and ride made them natural soldiers. This myth was debunked more than 40 years ago, but persists as an element of self-perceived national character that arguably affects Australian strategic decision-making to this day. Before moving to the strategic level of analysis, it is worth summarizing some key observations. Strategic culture, as defined here, is distinct from military institutional and organizational culture per se, though influencing it and tending to supersede and precede it. It is ethnically and nationally driven, derived from a combination of racial, religious, regional, geographical, and historical factors. It may be national or subnational, and it may be based on real or imagined traits. It tends to be both enduring and unexamined, or even unconscious, chugging along in the background without being noticed and despite changing circumstances. It involves intersectionality between national, subnational, and organizational cultures, and may invoke aspects of fictive and contingent identity. It manifests itself in the ways individuals and organizations make sense of reality, in noticing and not noticing, selecting experiences to be remembered or forgotten, determining what attributes an organization values or scorns, framing and defining situations, and in the inclusion or exclusion of events from categories, such as war. Evolutionary anthropologists might argue, as in the case of German Auftragstaktik discussed earlier, that the development of a common cultural outlook can be considered an adaptive trait, that is, one that increases the survivability of a military organism, when it produces bonds of trust that facilitate rapid and dynamic maneuver, simplifies command and control, or generates, even through fictive aspects such as the Anzac myth, motivating ideas that help mobilize and energize a force. At the institutional level, such a culture can also help preserve corporate memory, ensure effective transmission of complex concepts and plans, and generate a self-healing command climate. But clearly, as military capabilities, technologies, adversaries, and environments evolve, once adaptive traits can become maladaptive, ultimately undermining their conscious or unconscious purpose. Herbert Simon's notion of bounded rationality, in which actors respond to stimuli in a rational manner within certain environmental bounds, but act non-rationally once they reach the limits of cognition or situational interpretation, is helpful here. It is only a slight extension of Simon's theory to include group norms, expectations, and sense-making frameworks as cultural elements of the cognitive limits and structures of the environment that he argues define the bounds of rational decision-making. Again, a Somali example is useful. Consider the tactical situation of Task Force Ranger in Mogadishu at precisely 16:20 hours on October 3, 1993, the moment when the first Black Hawk downed Super 6-1 crashed in the city. At that moment, the raid's objective had already been achieved. The SNA safe house near Bakara Market had been assaulted, and the Somali militia leaders who were the raid's targets had been captured and loaded in trucks for extraction, and were awaiting departure for the task force's base at the Mogadishu airport. Commanders knew the time was critical, as swarms of militia were already closing in to block the convoy's route back to the airport. Yet, after waiting a full 6 minutes under increasing fire, at 16:26, the convoy began moving, not toward the airport, but toward Super 6-1's crash site, attempting to locate and extract survivors, even though aircraft were already overhead and another quick reaction force had already been dispatched to the site. By 16:28, 2 minutes after the convoy began moving, aircraft orbiting overhead confirmed that Super 6-1's pilot and co-pilot were dead and that the Delta Force sniper pair assigned to the aircraft was nowhere in sight. Yet, the convoy kept fighting to the crash site for another 26 minutes, an eternity in an urban firefight of that intensity, running a gauntlet of multiple ambushes, losing its route back to the airport, and suffering 50% casualties, wounded or killed in action, in the process. Clearly, rational military decision-making is not a sufficient explanation for behavior in what was later dubbed the Lost Convoy. Cultural factors, in particular the unbreakable rule of no man left behind, played a decisive role. Commanders knew their mission required them to extract the high-value targets to their base, but they moved to the crash site anyway, in response to cultural imperatives, or what we might call combat norms, rather than fully rational judgments. In Simon's terms, the loss of Super 6-1 had pushed them beyond the bounds of rational decision-making by changing their cognitive frameworks, from raid to rescue, and their perceived structure of the environment, from the end of a successful capture mission to the beginning of an urban battle to recover the downed aircrew. Within 2 minutes of starting the move, they knew the crew members were almost certainly dead and that another convoy was headed for the site, yet they continued, driving through ambush after ambush with their valuable Somali captives in the back of the truck. Without in any way second-guessing commanders on the ground, this incident illustrates clearly that cultural norms that were once adaptive traits, units that leave nobody behind can count on higher morale, especially in dangerous light infantry missions, become maladaptive in the special circumstances of Bakara Market in the late afternoon on that fateful day. Strategic culture, statecraft, and strategy. With this as background, it is now appropriate to lift our analysis to the strategic level and consider how strategic culture interacts with statecraft and strategic decision-making. In this context, an established model in strategic theory holds that strategic culture drives patterns of national statecraft, which in turn drive military strategy. Like other forms of culture, strategic culture changes slowly, if at all. Therefore, even a perfect defense policy or military strategy is likely to fail if it does not align with strategic culture, a policy that lies outside the boundaries of culturally normative strategic behavior will simply not be followed. Strategic culture, as we've seen in the examples already discussed, consists of the traditional cultural, historical, political, and societal factors that help shape the defense policies and strategic behavior of countries. Numerous theorists have argued that, over time, grand strategy derives from strategic culture, which emerges from enduring geographical, economic, and historical circumstances rather than from leaders' conscious decisions. Inherent in the notion of strategic culture is the idea that a nation's enduring circumstances give rise to a distinctive manner of perceiving and using national power, including military force. Grand strategy, in the generic sense of national security strategy, seeks to coordinate and direct the resources of a nation or a band of nations towards the attainment of goals defined by fundamental policy. Some nations, for example, the United States, Australia, the United Kingdom, and the Russian Federation, express their national security strategy formally through official government documents. More commonly, grand strategy may simply be an observable pattern of behavior enacted in pursuit of long-term goals. Thus, grand strategy occupies the same mental space as strategic culture, often chugging along unexamined in the background, rarely or never consciously articulated. One characteristic of grand strategic behavior, however, is that it tends to be independent of the political orientation of a particular administration. This can be illustrated diagrammatically. See Figure 1. In this model, enduring strategic circumstances inform national culture, a subset of which is strategic culture, which, as we have defined it, is in turn that subset of ethnic or national culture relating to the use of force. According to theorists like Ada Bozeman and Edward N. Lutwak, an underlying strategic culture, in turn, drives patterns of statecraft, which inform broad policy settings, which in turn drive specific policy decisions. Each level of this cognitive model tends to change more slowly than the levels above. Enduring circumstances may last millennia. National culture changes over centuries and strategic culture over decades. Policies change with each administration over years and months, while decisions occur in days and minutes. Thus, patterns of statecraft tend to be more enduring.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.